sure.
No, I haven't read, I've read some of her other books. I read Vita and what else have I read?
No, of course not. I also need to know the rules.
That's where it's like outside. It's not.
Who's your chap?
Yes.
You hit no for better.
Yeah.
That's one place I feel like
I'm in the middle of it. I agree. You'll find even worse.
Yeah.
Well, less so. The mentality is also similar. Feels different.
I'll let you know when I finish. Okay.
Well, I don't know enough to say, but I'm sure. Yeah.
I guess we're at too much of a distance to see the point.
And I think the more fundamentally, the more all doesn't even matter. Yeah, I know. I'll be the right
one.
Good. Isn't he supposed to be the one?
Yeah, I do know. Well, the thing is, he's
coming.
Is he?
Yeah.
I was on Jim Hightower's radio show.
Oh, really? Well,
I thought about it, but you know, how far can you get here?
All right, everybody. Get started.
The sooner we get started, the sooner it's over.
That's right. But what is it about Stuart? You sent me a CV. It's too long to read.
Yeah.
But suffice to say, he's what a wonderful human being. He's also a neuroscientist, and he has written two great books, in addition to lots of papers. And he wrote a book on ignorance and a book on failure. And he decided, just to keep that sort of consistency going, he'd come and spend some time at SFI. And he's writing his new book, which he'll tell us all about today. So,
okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you all for coming out for this. I wasn't sure whether I'd be talking to an empty room and a screen or whatever. It's such a pleasure to actually have a chance to talk to people again. So that's great. And thank you to David, who I called him a couple of months ago and said, I need to learn some more about uncertainty and complexity and things like that for this book project I'm working on. And can I come out and visit? And he said, yes, absolutely. You make a perfect fractal faculty, which I continue to take as a compliment, although I'm not absolutely sure if that's the case, but that's what I am. So as David mentioned, just a quick introduction, my day job is a neuroscientist. My laboratory, which is Columbia, works on the sense of smell, olfaction, mammalian sense of smell mostly, which nobody cared about really until COVID, of course, and people began losing their sense of smell. So we'll talk about that some other time. I have other things I'd rather talk about now. And as you pointed out, I wrote these two other books kind of by accident, but they've been very gratifying in that they have spoken to an audience, not only of scientists, but of non-scientists, and most gratifying and unexpected, of educators who I feel are extremely important, science teachers, especially at the high school level, but even at the college level. And they were on ignorance and failure, so having sort of cornered that niche, I thought I'd have to come up with something a little different. And that's what this new book is about, what I'm going to talk about. So in both of those cases, though, just as a preamble to this, I found it that talking about things like ignorance and failure, which implicitly we all kind of know about and kind of agree with. I mean, it's kind of trivial in a way almost to say that science is about what we don't know and that something north of 90% of the experiments we try or the ideas we have fail. So there's nothing particularly new about that. But I did find that when you take what is an otherwise implicit idea that we all believe we understand and really lay it out on the table and try and make it explicit and think more deeply about it, you often find things out that you had sort of taken for granted or left behind and things like that. So that's also kind of the purpose with this book, which has a sort of the running title since I have these one word books that I've gotten trapped into. For the moment, it's optimism. And it's optimism because I think it's a little considered part, but integral part of science and the way we do science and the way science relates to society, the history of science and all of these other things. And I think it doesn't get talked about much. If you go out and look in popular science books, you'll find that, you know, if you just go to the index, you'll never see the word optimism, with one exception that I know about. David Deutsch's book, The Beginning of Infinity, actually has a chapter on optimism, although from a different angle than what I do, or what I'm trying to do. So, all right, so. Seem to want to go anywhere. Why doesn't want to go anywhere? There we go. Oh, there it went. Okay. All right. So I'm going to try and keep this sort of on the short side. I don't really know what you guys do here in terms of timing, but I'm much more interested, of course, in feedback. That's what I'm here for. And I'm here through the end of the week. Well, I'm here actually through the beginning of the week. I'll be here over the weekend. And you know, I'd like to talk to as many people as possible. And I hope to come back sort of at the end of October. I have to go back to New York because my daughter's getting married. So, you know, I thought all I had to do was sign checks, but apparently I have to do that. So I have to go back for that. All right, so I'm just going to give a quick sort of outline, which I kind of start at the end. So this is where I want to go towards through the whole thing. But I do want to leave a lot of time for discussion. So, and you can stop me all the way through. I don't care. So by the end of this, one of the things I'm especially interested in is how we are going to communicate science in a way that cannot be imitated. And this will become clear towards the end. I think one of the biggest problems that we deal with now with science and pseudoscience, if you will, is that the way we communicate science is easy to imitate. And so whether it's just idiots or nefarious players or whatever, but it's easy enough for them to imitate what we do and make it look like science and palm it off. And so one question is, can we begin to think about how to communicate science in a way it's not so easy to be imitated? Again, this is just a quick outline. So optimism, which I think will have something to do with this, I would like to suggest to you is a very recent idea. I think many people don't think that's the case. I'm going to try and show you that it's a fairly recent idea. In spite of which, over the few years that it's been around, a couple centuries, but nonetheless a recent idea, it has accumulated a lot of fairly superficial meanings, which I'd like to get rid of. I think it's an under and or maybe completely unrepresented element of science, as I said earlier. So my idea here is, again, by making it more explicit, is to complicate the idea of optimism, not to simplify it. I think the problem with it is become too simple an idea. I'd like to complicate it by removing the idea, by skipping over the idea, by not considering the idea that it's an emotional or psychological disposition towards cheerfulness or whatever that might be, or all those other things that we think about with optimism, but rather it's a philosophical matter rather than a psychological matter. It could be a stance, a kind of a worldview. And I hope to do that by showing that it's an integral part of science, that science works by being optimistic, that scientists are optimistic as a group. I include among them the cranky, disgruntled ones who we all know, not to single anyone out. But you know, I certainly know my share of cranky scientists who don't get their papers accepted or get grants rejected or whatever. They nonetheless come in every morning and they have experiments to do. They have things to think about. And they believe they might get an answer that day or at the worst, or maybe the best, a better question than they started out with. So I think either you're mad or you're an optimist if you're a scientist. And that's a critical part of doing it. But it's also, I think, a critical part of what science gives to society. That societies that embrace science are optimistic societies. Again, I mean it in this deeper way. I don't mean that you can't be happy or contented without science. I'm sure there are plenty of societies throughout history and today that have little or no science going on in them and are full of happy and contented people. But I don't think they're optimistic, at least in the way I would like to mean it. And then finally, I'd like to talk about uncertainty, pluralism, and how that adds to optimism, I hope. And basically what this amounts to is the transition from a kind of a very strong deterministic kind of a science to one that's instead grounded in, as you all know, irreducible kinds of uncertainties and complexities. And can we actually think of this as an almost second scientific revolution? And is it more or less the same optimistic as the more sort of deterministic one of Newton and so forth? So let me quick try a short history of optimism, because I think it might surprise you. So maybe the first sort of mention, although he never mentioned it explicitly, but the first idea in which optimism sort of comes up is from Gottfried Leibniz in the Odyssey, in which he makes this logical argument that we must live in the best of all possible worlds. Regardless of whether there's evil, disease, misery, et cetera, this is still the best of all possible worlds. A world without all those things would somehow be even worse, because after all, we have a benevolent and omnipotent creator. And unless you believe, as Woody Allen says, if there is a God, I don't know, but he certainly is an underachiever. And so unless you take that stance, you have to believe that this is the best of all possible worlds. This was ridiculed by Voltaire a few years later in his satirical novel, Candide. And actually, this is where the word optimism is invented, houle optimism. So Voltaire actually invented the word optimism in 1759. It did not exist before that. The roots for optimism, I suppose, optimus or optimum, existed under their Latin. But they always referred to a thing or a situation, the best example or instantiation of a thing or a situation. It had nothing to do with an attitude or a view. So this is the first use of the word optimism. Unfortunately, it has a somewhat negative meaning in Voltaire. It's a kind of naive gullibility. That is the idea that this is the best of all possible worlds. So, and it's different. I mean, the Leibniz version of optimism isn't so positive either. I would call it a kind of resignation. Really, to the extent that there was an optimistic viewpoint, it was, well, the world sucks. It's really bad, but it's as good as it's going to get. So let's just make the best of it, which is optimism by resignation, in my opinion. So there's a lot of contemporary uses, of course, all this other stuff, cheerfulness, positive thinking, mindfulness, have full glasses, et cetera, you know, the whole list. You can find them all in the self-help aisle in the bookstore, whatever's left of the bookstore. And of course, there's also this sort of evolutionary psychology idea about optimism that somehow or another it's baked into our brains, that evolution has baked optimism into us. And I think there's actually very little evidence for that. And I would say there's mostly evidence against it. I don't think optimism existed for a long time. I don't think it's, there wasn't even a word for it per se. And even if people sort of vaguely thought it, I mean, you know, it's hard to imagine what a feudal slave and, you know, medieval Europe thought about optimistically beyond a kind of a resignation of optimism. I mean, people for many generations grew up to do what their parents did, and their children grew up to do what they did. The records in medieval days show that people rarely strayed more than 12 to 13 miles from the place they were born. And so I don't know whether they were optimistic or not. They're not here to ask. Yeah?
What about faith?
What about
faith?
Faith?
Yeah. I mean,
yeah, so... Well, yes. So that's a good question. So you know, religion, of course, would attempt to do something like that. But again, it's always, at least through most of the medieval days, at least until the Reformation, for example, in the West, I'm talking about now, it was a very monastic view of the world. I mean, this was a crappy place, but you could do what you could to get to an afterworld, and that was the best you could hope for optimistically. And it was better later.
There's also like God will take care of us.
I'm sorry, you can take your mask off.
There's also like God will take care of us, Moses in the desert, you know. Just God will help you to go through your troubles and stuff like that. So that's kind of an optimism through faith, through the belief that whatever is happening is because God thinks it's best for you.
Yes, yeah, so but it's an optimism, how shall I say, without responsibility. I mean, it's, yes, we're the flock, you know, yes, we get taken care of like sheep do, but I don't know if sheep are optimistic either particularly.
Yeah.
You know.
Okay, so this is kind of more humanistic, anthropocentric.
Right, I'm looking for a more, you know, active optimism, right, if you will.
So you're wondering about evolutionary psychology. There's huge amounts of literature and behavioral game theory, behavioral psychology, and so on, where optimism is quite literally you are biased towards expecting a mean that comes out better than is actually justified based on the objective evidence. You know, everybody's above average. So far as I know, I mean, it's obviously complicated because of all this weird business, but so far as I know, that's actually a cultural universal. That's true across all societies, in particular down to hunter-foragers and so on. So do you have any reason to believe that's not always been the case, and therefore that it's not baked into our brains? In that very real sense, I expect that things will come out in a way that actually is better than is justified based upon my data.
I don't.
Well, there are probably many, many experiments showing that you do, actually. I'm not talking about things like what happens in the news. I'm talking just about things that...
Yeah, so I mean, there's a well-known book by Tally, somebody's name, last name I can't remember, in which she makes this case, rather strong, man. I mean, she makes a lot of citations and all that. Most of it, I have to say, is based on kind of, yes, the idea that if you look at sort of social science or psychological experiments with people, they tend to overestimate how good they are, how good things are, this or that, this, that, or the other thing, how good things will turn out. That's all done on current populations. To make the leap that this is therefore then baked into our brains, these biases are baked in by evolution, I think is a big leap.
Myrta might know better than I do, but as far as I know, this has actually been found cross-culturally.
You mean overconfident?
Well, that may be too, but it's still modern. We're still talking about a modern world, basically, right? I mean, I still don't think you can jump easily from that to say, well, this has just been, you know, this is part of the way our brains work.
To be sure, we don't... It's not like it's come out of what's called evolutionary preferences, where people have found the gene for it or something like that.
Yeah, I'd also say that again is a kind of an optimism, which is sort of a, you know, positive thinking optimism, which I hope to show you is not the kind of optimism that I think is, well, that I'm trying to talk about and that I think is even more interesting. So, I mean, whether... you know, people were generally cheery before or have always been sort of on the cheery side. That may be, but I still don't think that optimism as a vision, as a stance, as a worldview existed in that way. And I certainly don't think that's baked into our brains, because I don't think, well, even if it was baked into our brains, I can't imagine why many people would feel that way prior to the existence of modern science.
This evolutionary psychology statement is totally against Buddhist philosophy.
Totally against?
Buddhist.
Yeah.
Buddhist philosophy, where the best strategy is to have no expectations. And then you just do the best you can without any expectations.
Yes.
And that leads to happiness.
So again, I make no bones with happiness, cheerfulness, contentedness, a sense of self-value, any of those sorts of things. I think, yes, I think various kinds of theologies, various kinds of philosophies have attempted to work that out before, and whether it's evolutionarily baked into us or not, I don't know. But again, it's not exactly the kind of optimism that I hope I'll be talking about. So yes, I think that's true. But so, for example, I think the kind of, to get a little bit ahead of the story, but then I'll try and go back on this, I think the kind of optimism I'm talking about requires a notion of progress, which you tend not to find in theologies or philosophies of a Buddhist bent, or even most philosophies, frankly, before Judeo-Christian, which were circular or recurrent rather than linear, and don't really give you a feeling for don't really give you the opportunity for progress in the way we think of it today, which I think is an important part of the optimism I'm talking about. So yes, I think all of those things are there. I think there are ways to lead a very satisfying, good life without science. I don't want to claim that if you don't have science, you're lost. But I do think it adds something very special in the way of optimism, in a much deeper kind of optimism. Sid, were you going to say something?
Well, yeah, I mean, just, you know, and as a counterpoint, maybe we could do a short history of pessimism. And I'm just curious, like where does Thomas Hobbes fit into this? Life is
Short. Actually, I recommend to you, because I borrowed a phrase from it. In fact, there's a wonderful book, I think an excellent treatise on this by, he's actually a political philosopher named Joshua Dienstag. And he has a book called Pessimism, in which he traces pessimism, again, with the idea of getting, of not just using pessimism as a kind of a, oh, you know, you're just some dour, sour character who thinks everything turns out for the worst, of which there are plenty, by the way, as well as the optimist. So that could be baked in some way, too. But he would also like to see pessimism be thought of as a philosophy. And indeed, you know, Nietzsche, Schopenhauer, the list is almost endless. Sartre, Camus, all those people certainly had a kind of a pessimistic philosophy, which does not nonetheless lead you to suicide, at least. So Camus would lead you to believe or would want you to believe. I'm sorry, there was another hand up. Yeah.
Could you speak a little bit about what you think about optimization as in terms of like what you think it is about societies with science that are optimistic?
Yeah, it's interesting because they have the same root, right?
Right.
So I've thought about this a bit on and off, and I don't have a good clear idea about it yet. Optimization tends to be in my head, in my mind, I'm trying to get rid of this in some ways, but optimization tends to be in my mind a sort of a technical issue. You optimize a thing, a machine, a cure, a gadget, whatever it might be that you've worked on, or even a, you know, an equation, a statement, a theory, you can sort of optimize it. But that seems to be a kind of a technical approach to things. Now, I still think the feeling that you can optimize things, the idea that optimization is possible, that we have not come up with the optimum, that it's not the best of all possible worlds, that is optimistic. In that sense, I think optimization is an important part of being optimistic. That is this notion that, well, I'll come to that in a minute. Let's see if this satisfies you in a moment. Maybe I'll get rid of this evolutionary psychology line because I'm causing way too much trouble. So, I thought for a while before I put it in there to tell you the truth, but I thought, well, I'm not as well. Anyway, what I'm interested in is the scientific optimism, and I find the phrase that I like, which I borrowed, by the way, from this guy Dienstag, not exactly, I've rephrased it a bit, but I, to some extent, borrowed it from this guy Dienstag, whose book is on pessimism, the notion that it could be otherwise, that the way we find things, the way things are, is not the way they need to be. That we could understand them, we could explain them, we could grasp them in such a way, we could even change them. Sometimes for the better, sometimes for the worse, but they needn't be the way we find them. That we have this agency in the world. And to me, this is sort of the basis of what I would call scientific optimism. That this was not thought, and I'm thankful to David for having suggested this word to me as a sort of a one-word option for it, but that is the notion of possibility, which I think is to some extent wrapped up in optimization, right? I mean, the idea that we can optimize means that it could be better, it could be otherwise.
Yeah, I have a question. Yeah. So how does it relate to modernism? It seems to be borrowing things from the modernistic modernism as a philosophy. Very much so, I think.
Well, so I'm not a philosopher, so I don't have an easy answer for that. I think, in the sense of the word modern, I think it has to do with modern science. So it is something that comes along with what I would call modern science, which I'm going to talk about in sort of a moment, I guess. Let me go on for a minute and then ask me that maybe again. So, all right, so science becomes modern. So there's a, in the philosophical and historical science literature, there's a vast debate about whether there was such a thing as the scientific revolution or not. Should we call it a revolution, et cetera, et cetera. And I would like to not bother with all of that. I mean, just because I'm not a philosopher and I'm not a scientist, so what I have to add to it is going to be minimal. I think what you can say is that at some point, science became modern. Yes, there were many antecedents to what we do today. The Greeks had science, the Egyptians, Mayans, Chinese, Arab, et cetera, et cetera. But nonetheless, there's something, kind of a jump, it seems to me, in when science became modern, which I would say happened around the end of the 16th century or so. And I think it was a kind of a cognitive revolution, I would say. It involved people like, you know, I know the old boys club, as it were, or as David pointed out, some of them were young, but they were boys. Copernicus, Francis Bacon, Galileo, Vesalius. And I think there were sort of a set of ideas that coalesced at this moment in sort of medieval Europe around the 1600s. And I think it's of interest for our purposes here, because I think the reason that it was so valuable or what was seen as so valuable at that time in Europe was that Europe at that time was about the most fucked up place in the world. I mean, it was ridden with crime, with plagues, with wars, with all kinds of famine and various natural disasters, none of which could be easily explained by people. I mean, nobody had any explanations for these except that, you know, God is kind of pissed off at us, apparently, but we don't really even know why. So Europe was kind of really crap hole, as it were, of the world. And I think that in some ways, the growth of science in that situation was an attempt to bring some order to what was seen as almost total chaos, which is interesting because we're now getting rid of the order and looking at chaos as being more interesting. But I think the initial impetus was actually to find some order in all the chaos. Yeah.
Wait a second.
Okay.
I mean, historically, no. Just why? Europe was not exceptional either in the positive or the negative until basically after the Scientific Revolution. You're talking about the time scales actually where Europe was originally getting somewhat richer and wealthier. Life was definitely far worse by almost any measure in many other places, and it was better in many other places. Europe was middle of the road until like a century or so after. I mean, there's many theories for what caused the Scientific Revolution, Catholicism, many people claim, and so on and so forth. The fact that you're saying life was extraordinarily crappy, and anywhere life is crappy enough, you're going to get science?
So I can't tell you that it was crappier everywhere else in the world, but I think it was. I think the records are very clear that it was pretty rough in Europe then. There was plague after plague. There were natural disasters. There was a mini ice age. There were famines of one sort or another. The 15th to the 16th century in Europe has the highest, historically at least, the highest homicide rate of any place ever recorded in the world.
There are many other places where life had been very
crazy. I'm sure life has never been easy in many places, but I think Europe was particularly, I mean, for example, I would say China at the time, from what records there are, was hierarchically organized. It was Confucianism. I think it was a more orderly place. I think the Arab world was far more orderly. It hadn't gone through the whole medieval business and so forth. I think the caliphates and things like that, it was a more orderly place. That's all I really want to say. I don't want to make a big issue out of it. I just think that Europe was an excellent breeding ground for science, for this the kind of science that we practice today, because it did try and explain what otherwise seemed like an awful lot of chaotic occurrences. I mean, the 30 Years' War in Europe was one of the worst wars that has ever been. I mean, we've had some bad wars on this planet in a lot of places, but the 30 Years' War just, you know, decimated the population of Europe. Famines decimated the population.
Talking just about China, the overthrow of the Song Dynasty a couple of centuries before this, that gave the Yuan Dynasty, estimates are a quarter to one half of the population was decimated. This was the Mongol.
Yeah, I understand that. But still, you know, replacing a dynasty with a dynasty is still a different thing than a bunch of feudal warlords who never get anywhere, who just keep fighting. It seems to me. I mean, that's my take on it. I'm not trying to claim that this is, you know, that every place else was a picnic and, you know, and Europe was the worst. But I think it was an excellent breeding ground for some explanatory principle, for some kind of way of thinking that provided some explanation for the way things were going that seemed so unpredictable and totally chaotic and generally bad. So in any case, I would say there were five sort of main cognitive leaps to my mind. I'm sure we could make a list that's longer. You may not agree with these. I'm sure you won't agree with them. But in any case, one of them is a simple rejection of authority. This is a phrase from Bacon that I happen to personally like a great deal because it's so simple, which he says previously, truth came from authority, and henceforth authority will come from truth. And I think that's, in a relatively small number of words, a kind of a big thought. That comes from the idea of experiment. Again, something I think that we all believe, or many of us would believe, has been around for a long time. And I would like to suggest to you that it is not. I don't mean trial and error, and I don't mean experience. I mean the notion of experiment in which you, this sort of term cateris paribus, that all of the things being equal, that you isolate a single thing, that you isolate a small piece from the whole, and yet you believe you can learn about the whole from that small piece. So the idea of doing experiments, I think, is one of the great inventions, in fact, of science that did not exist before this time. Of course, if you do experiments, you know that you get a lot of failure, but I've dealt with that elsewhere, so talk about that. I think the notion of provisional truth, the notion that things can be not entirely true, that you don't have to go for truth with a capital T, that that's a theological pursuit or other kinds of pursuits, but that science is happy with provisional belief, that things get less wrong, ideally, but not necessarily more right. And the value of the counterintuitive. So I think it's often said that many scientific advances or ideas have been made by intuitive leaps. And I suppose that's true in some way, but I would say most of them are really rather counterintuitive leaps. And it's the ability to embrace the counterintuitive that I think is also one of the special abilities that science brings. It's not based on common sense at all, but again, goes back to experiment. If the experiment works, then even if it's counterintuitive, one accepts this or one works with this. So what follows from all this, of course, is also the notion of progress, which I think is, again, one of these words that seems like it's been around for forever. And we assume that people have been making progress since they were painting pictures on cave walls. But and that's certainly true, that progress does occur. But progress, I think, occurred at such a slow rate for so many years, even with people whose brains the same size and structure as ours, that it was virtually imperceptible. Yes, there were little flashes of it here and there, the early Bacon, Da Vinci, people like that in the West, at least, and other places certainly made bits of progress. But for the most part, I mean, you know, something like the Bronze Age, which is the first sort of technology that we had, lasted for 50 generations. So for 50 generations, people with brains just like ours effectively were born, grew up, and died in virtually the same technology. And so I think progress was virtually imperceptible. But when it accelerates to the point that it has in the last, say, 400 years, then the idea of progress becomes palpable. So I don't want to make any big issues about whether progress is good or bad, whether some of it's good or some of it's bad, or any of that. Now, that's irrelevant. But the important thing to me is that the idea of progress becomes something that any person can entertain, that we can all entertain, that we indeed come to expect it almost. And so resignation as a way of dealing with things is replaced with the idea that it could be otherwise, that we could optimize, let alone invent and understand. I think one of the ways this progress occurs in science especially is by the ability of science to embrace what are often paradoxical or opposing ideas. The most important of those, I think, is hubris and humility, that you can do this. Both of these are critical parts of science, that in order to perform, in order to get to the lab in the morning to do what we do, I think you have to have a tremendous amount of hubris. Imagine the hubris that, well, it's not hard to imagine the hubris that Newton had. There's a pretty good record of it, I guess. But in general, scientists, the idea that we can figure this out, that we can come to some decent kind of knowledge of all of this, and yet the humility that goes along with knowing how little of it we really know, how often we're wrong, how often we have to revise. I think great historian of science, Charles Gillespie, once said that in science, revision is a victory. It's not so true in many other places, yeah.
I'm a little confused as to, so you mentioned earlier that the kind of paradigms that, you know, given by different religions or spiritualities don't fit within this framework, they're not what you want to talk about. However, so you characterize your notion of optimism as the possibility of change, and I don't see how spirituality does not fit that definition.
Can you tell me how it does?
Yeah, because, you know, spirituality can be seen as a recognition that I can make a better person of myself. At least that's one aspect of it.
Yeah, I guess I think that most cases of at least organized religion are not, don't aim at that. I mean, they aim at, you know, they would have hubris and humility in them, but they're separate, you know, there's hubris among the priesthood and humility among the flock is the way that goes, right?
Sure, organized religion.
Yes. So spirituality, yes, but I think that there are, I think there may be, you know, short bursts or flames of this in an individual, but there's no general practice of it. There's nothing about spirituality, I think, as a general practice that you can then say leads this way or that way. I mean, it's very individual. Yeah, there are people who, and I have nothing against that. I think you can practice science and be and still be spiritual. I don't see them as being in conflict. So yes, that's possible, but I don't see it as being, I don't think you could write down a list of what the crucial elements of spirituality are, or, you know, without having some organized spirituality, without having a leader and a flock kind of thing. Maybe one could, I can't. So I see it as different in that sense.
Okay.
One thing you might want to do, think about at least, is drawing a division between transcendently induced optimism and imminently induced optimism.
And which?
Imminently. So imminent optimism is, this world can be improved. Transcendent would be, I will go to a better place, which the religions do. And you can avoid that confusion.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I think that's what I've sort of been trying to say in a way, but yes, that makes it clearer. Thank you. Yeah. Hold on.
When you talk about progress, are you talking about scientific progress that is getting closer to some truth, objective truth, or are you talking about improvement of society due to technology, technological
progress? Yeah, so I'm talking about scientific progress. Progress. Among philosophers, progress is a huge can of worms. And of course, it's hard to know how to talk about. I mean, can you talk about progress in the arts? I mean, is Beethoven progress over Bach or something like that? These seem like silly questions. So, is there social progress? Is liberal democracy better than authoritarian government? A question that we could all legitimately ask now as to whether in fact it is or not, right? Although we've always seen that as progress. So it's a little harder to figure out in those areas. So I'm limiting my idea of progress to scientific progress. Now that can include technological progress, but it can also include simple intellectual, if you will, or understanding or explanation. So I like to use the word, instead of explanation, which I think is what science does a lot of, I like to use the idea that we grasp, that science enables us to grasp things. So we understand things or explain things, we come to an understanding, but in the sense of grasping, because grasping has this odd sort of, you can wield it kind of thing, right? Once you grab it, you can wield it as well. So we use it in both ways, and I kind of like the both ways that we use it. So that's the kind of progress, I think, the progress of grasping the universe in a more complete, in a more correct way, if you will, a more real way. But again, provisionally, changes, that's fine. So other sort of, yeah.
It's a part of the complexity here is that the data you want to use to support your argument are not necessarily the same as the argument, right? So if you talk about centuries of invariance, that sounds, to Melanie's point, that sounds like a instrumental engineering intervention, right? But you could imagine huge progress in mathematics
mm-hmm.
that had no demonstrable effect
mm-hmm.
at all on your standard of living. And so I wonder whether it might be dangerous to use the historical data on how we live. Is there sanitation? Is there sort of further the scientific progress argument, which has to do with challenging authority, contesting widely held beliefs, none of which have to be consequential in practical terms.
Yes. So I think that's true. I think mm-hmm. from a and that's certainly true for those of us who work in science, for people who are scientists, I think that's absolutely true for the most part. I think for the sort of wider public, that sort of technology, that standard of living business, is at least a sort of a symbol. It's what allows them to recognize that science is, that progress is possible, mm-hmm. that there is an idea of progress that, that is something different than what's been before. So I think it's valuable that way, but I agree with you in terms of a deeper understanding of what we mean by progress. Yes, I would not limit it or even maybe use technological processes. Progress is the best way to think of it. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, the Greeks were interesting this way. The Greeks didn't even, as I understand it, I don't know ancient Greek, but I'm told that the ancient Greek doesn't actually possess a word for progress, several words that sort of go around it, and that progress was actually seen as kind of an evil in Greek philosophy, that change was dissolution and decay. That, I mean, you have Icarus and Prometheus and Hercules, and none of them came out well for trying to do things differently. The Greeks preferred stability. And stasis, and that was considered the best way to go rather than progressing, as it were. So in spite of their mathematical progress, but you know, maybe that's why they came up with geometry instead of calculus, right? You know, it's just nice and stable, as it were. Okay, so a couple of other sort of opposing ideas that I think science manages to work with, which is interesting in terms of the way we're able to think, is that we understand how to reason, but we have constraints about reasoning, which goes kind of back to experiment. And this notion that we can be enchanted by science, and yet we can be skeptical. We can have a childlike awe at the wonder of what's going on, and yet operate with a kind of an adult skepticism at the same time. And somehow or another, we can hold these ideas together in our heads. So this is where I begin to run into a little bit of a problem. I think I began to run into a little bit of a problem. What brought me here, so now I've gone on way too long with this. And that is that eventually this successful science, this technologically successful science, leads to a kind of a view of the world as being deterministic. It leads to a kind of a clockwork universe model of the world. And that turns out to be, I think, not so optimistic, because now things are, well, you did hubris way over humility. Certainty replaces possibility, it seems to me. If the universe is a clockwork, if it's all going to be the way the laws say it is, even if we don't know the laws yet in a sort of Laplacian way, then it can't be otherwise, in fact. So that kind of goes out the window. So we have a science that's technologically successful, but gives us a somewhat degraded robotic view of nature, that it's just ticking away according to some very predetermined plan. And I think this gives rise, among other things, to some of the worst ills that we place at science's doorstep, in the Enlightenment in particular, things like eugenics or planned societies, utopian dreams of various sorts or another that kind of are all went wrong, if you will. So I think that although this deterministic kind of science was very successful in bringing order to the chaos of medieval and post-medieval life, all the way up and through the Enlightenment, it may be at the cost of a deeper kind of optimism of possibility that goes out the window. Yeah,
Chris. I'm loath to take up your time. I'm just, when you say certainty replaces possibility, it could not be otherwise. It feels to me like there's a bit of a category error there, because I could believe that there are laws of nature and that they do determine things. I could still be happily unsure about what those laws are. In other words, I could be uncertain about how the machinery works, even though I think there is some machinery. I don't know if that's an interesting out, but it seems to me that the could not be otherwise is operating on two very different levels there. Like, what will happen given the laws of the world, and what are the laws of the world?
Yeah, this is a little bit of a... that's true. You could, I suppose, believe that science will eventually give us the ultimate explanation. We will ultimately have a couple of equations that will explain the whole thing. But after all, how close are we to ultimate? So why should we be worried about that? And that's true to some extent, I agree. But nonetheless, the overarching idea is that we can get there, and that getting there has already been predetermined, whether you like it or not, that there's a certain kind of fatalism to all of this. So that's kind of the way I mean it, in the sense that, you know, in there's a branch of psychology work now on depression, in which they've begun to identify certainty as a major symptom of depression. That people who are depressed suffer from an overarching kind of view of the world as being certain, because it's just going to turn out that way. There's really nothing I can do. There's a loss of agency that comes from a belief in certainty, a belief that things are going to work out the way they're going to work out. And so while uncertainty may create anxiety in people and things like that, it doesn't create depression, because there is, at least you still have some skin in the game. There are options, there are possibilities.
So the other thing I wanted to say is that the laws we talk about in science are not always the sort of Leibnizian or microphysical laws. I mean, the quote unquote law of natural selection explains a lot, but I don't think we think of it as determining the future, because there are so many different ways that evolution could go. And,
that's going to be like two slides great. Later. Great. You're absolutely right. You're absolutely right. I mean, I think that is in some ways the key to it. So the question is this an alternative to determinism? Could we even go so far as to call it a second scientific revolution? And I think this begins, and maybe I'm biased because I'm a biologist and I've had enough of hearing history and philosophy of science through the eyes of physicists and so forth. So I'm going to claim it was a biologist who started this off, and that Darwin was really the first to show or to theorize, to suggest that that you can get tremendous complexity and organization out of a fundamental irreducible randomness with a feedback loop, of course, which he called natural selection, not having the word feedback. And that suddenly randomness became this possibility that there was no determinism. So yes, the example I would use is that that with evolution, you can say, we can understand, we can explain how, in a sense, or understand rather well, how we and chimpanzees both came from a common ancestor. But if all you had were the common ancestor, you couldn't predict either us or chimpanzees. Right? So we can understand it, but it doesn't necessarily mean that we can predict it. Indeed, as you know, you probably, many of you know this, this is the last paragraph in Darwin's Origin of Species, which I think contrasts these two ideas that he's managed to contrast, that grandeur in this view of life, several powers have been originally breathed a few forms into one, and that whilst this planet has gone cycling on according to the fixed law of gravity, very deterministic idea, from so simple a beginning, endless forms, most beautiful, most wonderful, have been and are being evolved. This non-deterministic view. And so he really contrasts these two things in this closing statement of the book. Intentionally, I don't know, but I'd like to think so. And indeed, much of the arguments that followed Darwin's publication of The Origin of Species and Wallace's work as well, were not, as we're taught to believe somehow or another, were not all about religion. Actually, there's very little about religion that follows from it, a few quirky, quacky things. But most of it, especially from other scientists, was this introduction of randomness as a real force. That was, I mean, you know, William Herschel, the astronomer, famously said, he called it, called it the law of higgledy-piggledy, which actually happens to be a perfect explanation of evolution, but he meant it in a derogatory way. And that was where really much of the discussion, post-Darwinian discussion in science went, or a lot of it did. So, but I think it's important to recognize that there's an optimism in this, right? This optimism of Darwinian disorder, if you will. So we go from Aristotle's Scala Naturae, which is kind of boring, really, and puts us on the top. And yes, there's this whole idea that, oh, Darwin knocked us off our perch at the top of things, just like Copernicus had done many years ago in the first scientific revolution. Also a story that's not true, by the way, total mythology, but current mythology. We can go into that later. But I don't think that's what Darwin did at all. In fact, I think what you get from Darwin and the famous idea of the tree is that it's not us at the top of a bunch of lesser creatures that exist on the planet. We are, in fact, on a planet that exists with everybody at the tip of their branch. everybody is as highly evolved as they could be for that species. So we live in a much more marvelous world, it seems to me, from a Darwinian point of view than from an Aristotelian point of view, where there's just a simple linear kind of scale. One example. All right, you all know this too well. I mean, Michael Simms, one of the famous, but not the last, and probably won't be the last, or the first or the last, to say that we know it all. It's probably not likely to change. Nothing much new is likely to happen in 1894, ending with the future truths of physical science. You look for in the sixth place in decimals, and you can contrast that with just maybe 30 years later, Haldane's statement, which is also, I think, equally well known to you all, that not only is the universe queerer than we imagine, it is queerer than we can imagine. Now this statement, which is used a lot, is often used to suggest that we are somehow or another cognitively constrained, that the real world is just beyond the possibility of this brain to actually imagine. But that's not the case, because there was a line that preceded this line, which is never quoted, but in which he says, "I have no doubt that in reality, the future will be vastly more surprising than anything I can imagine." So he saw a future. It wasn't that there was a constraint here at all. It was quite the opposite. It was that there are more possibilities that I can even begin to imagine than I can imagine having. So I find this a very optimistic statement about uncertainty. And then just to prove to you that I have some humanism in me, there's a quote from Hamlet. And there's Douglas Adams' one, which many of you probably also know, which he claims is a theory which states that if anyone ever discovers exactly what the universe is for and why it's here, instantly disappear, be replaced by something even more bizarre and inexplicable. And then, of course, there's another theory that says that's already happened. So here we are on that one. So here's an image that I borrowed from a artist, writer, and poet in the UK named Emma Cocker, who wrote a wonderful book, which you can't get a hold of, or can only get a hold of with some difficulty, called The Yes of the No. It's a brilliant book of aphorisms, I think. But it's, to her credit, you cannot get it on Amazon. So that's how good a book this is. You have to go to the English publishers and have them send it over to you. It's worth it if you get a chance. And she brings up this idea of the helmsman, the ability of the helmsman, which is what I like to think of as kind of the uncertainty and what science does in uncertainty. So she says, as the helmsman steers against the uncertain pressures of the water and the wind, he uses his capacity to harness the momentum of forces that are outside our control. So the notion is you have all this uncertainty of water and wind. We all know about those uncertainties, God knows. And yet the helmsman somehow or another can steer a course, can get you to port most of the time, one hopes. And so I like this idea of the helmsman as being what scientists are kind of practicing today, if you will. And I think this gives rise, finally, to a notion of pluralism in science, which I have thought of as being important for a long time, and I now realize even more so, and that it's more optimistic than I had ever realized. A lot of people like to use the word interdisciplinary. That gets thrown around a lot. I have developed a real distaste for that word and for the idea for a variety of reasons we can discuss. But I do like the idea of pluralism, which I think we should begin using to replace the idea of interdisciplinarity. And this is a quote from Charles Peirce, who, as you know, also believed in chance a great deal. He says, science is not like a chain, only being as strong as the proverbial weakest link, but rather it's like a cable made up of many delicate strands, but together, even though each one is fragile, together they have an immense strength. And the loss of a few of these strands will not significantly weaken the cable. And I think that's such an important idea that in science we can be pluralistic this way, such that a few wrong things here and there, even a large number of wrong things, will not significantly weaken the strength of the effort. This is just a Niels Bohr quote that I stuck in here. The opposite of a fact is a falsehood, but the opposite of a profound truth is often, of course, another profound truth. And that's also a kind of pluralism, I suppose. So, all right, so let me just get to the very last part of this, then we can go back over some of this if you want. And that is, how can this all be used to communicate better with the public? Because we now, I think, all recognize, because it's been brought to the fore, how difficult it is to communicate decent science with the public and go up against sort of the forces of pseudoscience. I mean, it's not the first time that science has had a rough patch with society. There was that stuff with the church early on and various skirmishes with governments and all. I mean, they used to burn us at the stake, so we're not there yet, so that's pretty good. But I think we now bring to the fore again this problem that philosophers have called for years the demarcation problem. You know, this is Popper's famous thing, how you can demarcate, how you can tell the difference between science and pseudoscience. I think it comes from this phrase that's been around for a while, I'm sure you've all heard as well, imitation is the sincerest form of flattery, because I think this is what pseudoscience, to some extent by its very name, precisely does, that the good news is that the pseudoscientists out there, the nefarious actors or the ones whose motives we can't even begin to understand, actually are somehow or other recognizing that science is fundamentally a very powerful tool because they're imitating it. I mean, it's basically what they do is a shabby imitation, I agree. They're, you know, it's a cheap, shabby imitation, but that's what they're doing. They're imitating science, claiming to use the same ideas as science uses, doubt, skepticism, rejection of authority, all of these things, and they're playing the same science game. So my question is, can a science of uncertainty be immune to imitation? Is this a way that we can begin thinking about communicating with the public about science that is more immune to imitation than the sort of deterministic thing? Can we actually consider uncertainty, randomness, complexity, et cetera, to be a kind of the demarcation that we've been looking for a long time between the science and the pseudoscience, as it were? Because remember, in the end, imitation may be the sincerest form of flattery, but flattery will get you nowhere, right? And we certainly know that. So that's the question. Can we reconform the whole curriculum to reflect uncertainty? I think one of the big problems that we have now is that we have left the wider public back in the 19th century world of deterministic science, of Newton and Maxwell, and I mean to put them down in any way, but you know, I teach a neurobiology class at Columbia, and at the end of the semester, I give an exam, and there are right answers and wrong answers. There's a yes or a no. You get credit or you don't get credit. I don't have an option on there that, you know, well, this is an impossible thing to know, or this is, we don't know this yet, or we could know this, or here's a better question, or I don't know, an infinity of other things. And then, you know, later on, these people have graduated and they come to us and say, well, you know, what should we do? Get a vaccine or not get a vaccine? Should we get a booster or not get a booster? Well, this and that, you know. And they say, well, that's not science. That's not the science that I learned. So can we reconform the curriculum to a science that treats uncertainty in its rightful place? And can we transform the pejorative public perception of uncertainty? I think I may have done this here, I'm not sure, but I'm gonna do it again because I don't know how many of you were in the room 5 years ago when I was here. But I'm gonna end this with a sort of a little bit of a joke, I hope, because I think sometimes humor is the best way to get these points across. And this notion of pluralism and multiple explanations and things like that. And this is a story called My Dog. It's really a story. This does happen to be my dog, or was my dog. I'm sorry to say he passed away. He's an old Newfoundland. The story of My Dog goes this way. Young Tom in the seventh grade is given an assignment to write an essay. So he decides to write an essay called My Dog. He hands the essay in, and 2 days later, the teacher comes back to him and says, Tom, your essay on My Dog is exactly the same as your brother's essay. Did you copy it? And Tom says, no, ma'am, it's the same dog. Right? So we all realize that's ridiculous and silly. And yet we don't think that way often about science. We think there's an answer. This is one answer. But it's not. It's the same dog. It's not the same dog. It's the same dog, but it's not the same dog. And so I guess I'll leave you with that notion, as it were. Okay, and maybe we can talk about this some more. You can give me a little more shit for this. Yeah, Chris.
So first of all, Neil Gaiman says that they had a cat named Ginger and their neighbor had a cat named Marmalade.
And after cat named what?
Marmalade. Oh. After some time, he realized they were the same cat.
But, I've had one of those cats, by the way, actually. Yes, I know.
So I have two questions. One is, when you say things could be different, and you also listed utopian societies as one of the ills of the Enlightenment, and certainly, you know, that's interesting, because the claim that things can be different is also in the social sphere, it's a revolutionary claim. We don't have to have capitalism. We don't have to have all these things that seem to be very permanent. But then you have people like Marx who claim to have this very dry, rigid, deterministic point of, you know, pseudo-scientific ability to predict historical determinism. And so it's interesting because I think the utopian impulse is potentially scientific, but it also, where it goes wrong is when it puts too much faith in its ability to optimize. So its ability to find the best solution and thinking that you can find the best solution and that it will always be the best solution is often a huge mistake. But thinking that things could be different from the way they are now, including in how society is structured, seems like a good thing. So that's one question. Like, you know, those different movements towards social progress, and to what extent they are correlated with or not your notions of scientific progress. And maybe I'll wait for some other people's questions before I ask my other question.
Yeah, I would say, I mean, just this is a quick response to that. I mean, the reason I use utopias as a kind of a negative, if you will, is that I see them as not an optimization, as an ending. I mean, they, you know, utopia is something where you've now figured it all out. I don't really know what you do in a utopia once you get there. I mean, it seems to me to be really boring. I don't know. What do you do, play golf all day or something? I hope not. So I don't see you. I see utopias as misguided in that way. I mean, the thing about science and that's so optimistic to me, and especially a science that recognizes a fundamental and irreducible kind of uncertainty, is that there's no end to that. There's no end in sight. Speaking of an end to that would be almost ludicrous. You can't imagine why there would be an end to that. Whereas deterministic science, even if we never get to the end, there is an end, right? You can see an end there. We may never get there, but you can see it. So endless change is the thing I'm interested in as optimistic. Yeah.
Yeah, so I was actually going to say something related to that, which is that in complex systems, a lot of people use the term optimization, which I think Caitlin asked about, in a very negative way. That uh-huh. Optimization assumes that you have some kind of static landscape of energy or fitness that you can then find the optimum. But in any complex system worth its salt, you would say actually there's no static landscape. You have a constantly changing landscape. And I love the analogy that our friend Brian Arthur always uses, which is living in a complex system is like living with a teenager. There's no way to optimize your behavior towards them because it's constantly changing. And so all you can do is adapt, continually try and adapt. And that's the opposite of optimization. So I don't know, that's just kind of a thought about how these things relate.
How do you feel about that?
I like that. I think the reason I asked is because of the very, you know, provocative Evo psych line of yours, but I was just thinking
get rid of that line. So
you know, like a modest interpretation of what evolution is like the optimization for a certain species in a certain niche, always happening all the time. So
yeah.
I think that's very well put. Thank you, Melanie.
Yeah.
So there are pragmatic concerns about trying to popularize this kind of cagey uncertainty. And I think David Kinney spoke to this in our transmission series last year, one of which is that we're in a crisis mode, then you want something that's reliable. And that the amount of time that it takes to sort of gather and assess information and the problem of providing a confidence interval, you know, like a spread of possibilities, to people that are in a position where they have to, you know, act in the moment. There's like fundamental tensions there. So like even looking at something like COVID, you know, when policymakers want to offer a program, an agenda, you know, advice, then they're left in the lurch by scientists insisting that philosophically that we can't offer you this. And I think that as the world continues to accelerate due to, you know, these sort of scaling law dependent dynamics, you know, that we get by increasing the sort of adjacency, that this is going to become a more and more acute problem. And so, yeah, while I agree that it is philosophically honest to bound things in this way, it seems like we will continue to encounter, like, this is sort of like the future shock issue, that people will double down on the need for something certain, even if it's wrong, and that we won't be able to aggregate information about right and wrong decisions on timescales that actually inform better decisions under uncertainty. And I'm curious what your thoughts are on that tension.
Well, I don't know the answer to that. I know that I agree from a pragmatic point of view, that seems like it should be problematic. But I think if we spent more time thinking about it instead of taking the obvious route of, you know, I think I mentioned this to David the other day, there's an anecdote about Harry Truman. Not a very anecdotal person, typically, but he was the first person to have a science advisor at sort of a cabinet level, actually. And at some point, he was reported to have yelled out in exasperation, could somebody get me a one-handed scientist? Because he'd get all this advice from his science advisor, and then he ended up by saying, but on the other hand, you know, so it's just been driving crazy. And of course, that's true. But look, we all have a great deal of experience with uncertainty, in fact, right? I mean, much of what we do in life, much of what we enjoy in life is based on uncertainty, whether it's gambling or sports. I mean, nobody would go or watch an athletic contest if they knew what the outcome was beforehand. We have a whole thing called a spoiler alert for that, right? I mean, does anybody in this room want to know the exact time and date of your death? I would kind of screw your life up a bit, I think, you know. Even knowing that you have a gene that's fatal is like a big problem for people. So I'm not sure that uncertainty is as awful as we think it is. I think it's been made that way. And this is a non-trivial. It's been made that way by people using this strategy of imitating science, of using doubt and things like that, that, you know, is kind of pioneered by the tobacco industry and is now utilized among climate change people. But I mean, you know, I always feel like, so blood pressure is something that we know a fair amount about, but not everything. We really don't know everything there is to know about how blood pressure is regulated. And there's several drugs on the market for blood pressure. Some of them work on ion channels, and some of them work on enzymes, and some of them are diuretics. And you have to play around with them to figure out which one is right, because it's not predictable. It's not really certain. So I'd like to go to some oil company executive who's claiming that we shouldn't do anything on climate change because we're not certain enough yet, and tell him to give up his fucking blood pressure medicine, because it's also not certain. And I don't think he'll do that, or she. So I think there's more opportunity than we think there is. I think we've been convinced by the pseudoscientific doubters and the Gwyneth Paltrow types and all the rest of that, that the public won't accept uncertainty, that the public wants to hear what it is right to do. And of course, we've had trouble with that, because that's what people have attempted to do during this pandemic, and then they change their mind. And then that's even worse. So it's even worse if you go out and make an absolutely certain 100% statement, scientific, and then it changes. This is why I hate this follow the science phrase that gets used a lot now. How can you follow the science? It's going in 20 directions. You can't follow it. You shouldn't follow it. That's a religious thing to do, is follow some shit, you know? So I think it's not as bad as it may look. At least that's my hope. I think there's an opportunity. We just have to think this through more carefully.
You're right, and actually the recent research suggests that presenting uncertainty to people does not necessarily decrease their trust in the source. I guess what we don't know is exactly how to communicate uncertainty, especially deep uncertainty, in an effective way. But it seems that if it's communicating well, it actually helps people to understand that there are wider confidence intervals, but it does not decrease their trust.
Yes.
Spiegelhalter works on that. Lewandowski.
Who does?
David Spiegelhalter.
Oh, yeah. That's the statistician that right. I was mentioning the other day.
And there's Gerd Gigerenzer's work is also a lot about that. Steve Lewandowski and this. I mean, all of these science communicators now understanding that.
Yes.
Communicating deep uncertainty is important, and we don't really know how to do it, so it's an open area. So I agree.
And I mean, I think to be able to say that we're 90%, or we're only 80% certain about this. We have 20% uncertainty. That's actually a very certain statement to make. That's a very precise statement to make. So you can have a tremendous amount of precision with uncertainty. It doesn't mean sloppiness. It doesn't, you know, it doesn't have to mean that. I mean, that's the way it's taken, but we could redefine that. What it really is.
And then there are also different gradations of uncertainty. So for example, IPCC, the climate change panel, they have a whole classification of different levels of uncertainty and types of uncertainty they try to communicate to people. Also in communicating of medical research, Cochrane Association that does a big meta-analysis of medical studies. They also have a specific kind of verbal two-dimensional classification of uncertainties related to different results. So I think there is a lot of attempts to try to define.
Certainly. it would be a great thing for society if scientists did communicate their uncertainty. A lot of the reason I suspect that there's been so much corrosion in trust in science is because scientists have so often said, oh, you know, if you have 5 blueberries for breakfast, that means you're never going to have prostate cancer. Oops, nope, we changed our mind next week. It's the uncertainty that's actually misplaced that gives science a bad...
Yes, I agree. I agree.
About it is, though, I'm not sure that actually solves your very... important problem that you put your thumb on, because why would it be difficult to imitate uncertainty? We think that cigarettes do not cause cancer, but we're not 100% sure.
Well, because I think that the purveyors of pseudoscience offer certainty. I mean, that's precisely what they're offering, right?
If you follow us, it would be an arms race.
I mean, they're offering uncertainty about the real science, but they're offering in its place a perfectly certain explanation. And that's where they would go wrong. Because if they want to offer something uncertain in place of the uncertainty they claim that science has, fine, but I don't think that will fly. I just don't think that's the PR that they work on.
Can you see a bit more about what this science that embraces uncertainty looks like? Because I'm having a hard time imagining what science would look like that it would make it hard to, you know, embracing uncertainty, that it would make it hard to imitate, because, you know, if we embrace uncertainty, basically I am willing to say that I don't really know. And if it's very easy for somebody else to say that, you know, look.
Well, but in point of fact, I don't think it is so easy. Yes, it's easy for somebody to say that, but we don't just say, I don't know. We say, I don't know which of these numerous possibilities is, you know, I can tell you which one I think is more likely to come true. I can tell you that there are numerous possibilities, some of which are better than others, and some of which are more acceptable than others, some of which are more likely than others, all of those sorts of things, which I don't think that's what somebody else saying I don't know means. But I also don't think that people who purvey this kind of pseudoscience ever say that I don't know.
But they could say it once science becomes the...
Well, they could, but then I think the air is out of their balloon. I mean, would you read an astrology column if you believed in astrology, if you had fallen for that bit? Would you read an astrology column that said, today's predictions are only about 40% accurate, but, you know, have a fun read.
Yeah, well, then nobody's going to care about science either, then.
Yeah. Well, I don't know about that, because
I think this is a little misguided, because it's not the utterance, it's the methodological implications of the position, right? So,
well, sure, of course. Yeah.
It's how you react to evidence.
Yeah, I mean, this is a way of saying it. That people can react that way as well.
No, but I guess my point would be that, it's not you're saying, I've discovered the ultimate Nash equilibrium for a sentence which cannot be invaded by pseudoscience, right? That would be ludicrous. Yeah. What you're saying is that there is a position, let me give an example, I mean, to Andre, that what we do as scientists, by and large, I mean, I don't want to be Bayesian, but if some evidence that is contrary to our belief appears, we update our belief. And at a certain point, we pass a threshold where we sort of gravitate to the alternative. The climate change deniers, 99% of the evidence that suggests it's happening is not enough. one experiment which is in line with their belief is enough, right? Yeah, sure. So it's an attitude to evidence.
Yes.
I don't know if it's a statement of your affiliation to uncertainty. That's where it would be problematic.
Okay, yeah.
But how is science not already that way?
You mean, well, science is that way? No, okay, I agree. Okay. That it, yeah. Right, that's right. That's where I'm...
Yes.
That's what science actually does. And maybe we articulate that a little better, but I must admit, I'm a little bit less convinced by the fetish of the uncertainty. I feel that I'm hearing that a lot these days, and I don't think it's enough. Precisely because I don't think it's stable.
I guess I don't think it's enough either. I just think it's a doorway into some.
Yes.
Some perhaps new place, you know. Yes. I mean, that's why I'm here, because I can't get it to be enough yet.
Right.
Well, I also think, if I may, it's not just that we admit or embrace uncertainty. It's that for us, uncertainty is a very, it's a positive thing. It's a living thing. I think when most people say, I don't know, it's the end of the conversation. They're basically admitting they have no, you know, they don't care about it, or they have no hope of figuring it out. Whereas for us, that leads to, oh, well, how would we figure that out? How would we find out? And I think that living generative notion of uncertainty, viewing it not as a defeat or a helplessness, is pretty special to our corner of the culture.
I want to push back a little bit on what you said, that you know, you talk about the pseudoscientists who have, you know, claim certainty. But I think the biggest danger is from the groups that are more misconstruing the uncertainty of scientists, like tobacco executives, you know, who they basically said, well, we, you know, there's a lot of uncertainty here. Or climate deniers who don't necessarily say there's no climate change. They never say that, but they just say there's a lot of uncertainty, so we shouldn't take any drastic action. And there is uncertainty there, you know, it's clear there's uncertainty, but they're misconstruing what the scientific consensus is, I think.
Yeah, so the worst case of that I've actually seen is, and I guess one could have predicted that it would go this way once the tobacco model became more popular, is that there was a conference that was run by a group called the NAS, or the NSA, which is not the National Science, the NAS, not the National Academy of Sciences, but some other, an acronym for something else. Turns out to be this wildly conservative, crazy group of people. And their whole thing was that science is so uncertain about everything, it should never be used to make policy. That, you know, science is steeped in uncertainty because that's what science is. Scientists themselves admitted, I mean, they were sort of jumping off the whole so-called replication crisis, which I think is another example of a false idea about science. I don't believe there's a replication crisis personally. I think failure to replicate is part of science. You often learn from that. It's a crucial ingredient to the scientific effort, is a failure to replicate experiments. And that's different than fraud. I'm not talking about a replication failure because somebody, you know, goosed up the data or did something fraudulent. For that, the only thing I believe in capital punishment for, actually, is scientists who do that. But if you publish what you think is reasonable data that you collected, but it can't be replicated, well, that's interesting. That means it's something you actually didn't account for, that you didn't even know you didn't account for, or that you accounted for without thinking about doing it.
But I think, as you said, that these fake NAS people are communicating the wrong message about what uncertainty means.
Yeah, so that's what I'd like to see us sort of, you know, change somehow or another. I'd like to see us take back control of that line, you know, because as Chris said, it's not an evil thing, it's not a bad thing, it's not, you know, it's not a mark against anybody. It's in fact what makes the whole thing work. And it works better because of it. So, but I mean, what the strategy is for taking that back, I have to say, I don't know. but I think there is, or could be. At least I think it's the strongest thing we can play, because it's where science is. And we ought to come to terms with that. I mean, I do think immediately we're doing the wrong thing in science education. I mean, there's a lot of worry about, you know, STEM and all the rest of that. Are we educating scientists? Are we gonna have enough scientists? I'm frankly not so worried about that. I think we do okay, probably could do better. But the people that really worry me are the ones for whom their last formal interaction with science was either a high school science class or some crappy college introductory class that they were sort of forced to take, which taught them that, you know, science has big textbooks, got a lot of facts in it. Know the facts, know science, that's it. And that's kind of a disaster, you know, that creates an audience that's susceptible to this doubt argument.
It seems like a lot of this book is ultimately about science communication. I wonder what you think about the uncertainty that creeps in when, like, evidence-based science method is communicated to an uninitiated audience, and that sort of distillation that, like, provides a different type of uncertainty, which is, like, fraudulent or not, most usually not, a misunderstanding.
I'm sorry, I'm not sure I understand that.
So, like, I've been doing the same type of science for 25 years in my lab, and I have this breakthrough. In order to completely demonstrate to a broad audience the merits of the breakthrough, you sort of have to distill 25 years of research into like one news article. And so there's a lot of uncertainty that creeps in there. And I wonder what you think about that as compared to this type of uncertainty that we're talking about, since this is like a science communication enterprise itself.
Yeah, so, I mean, I think this is an important area in science journalism. Yeah. Certainly, for example. And I think we also don't do a very good job of that. I mean, I know a lot of science journalists, and we have a big science journalism program at Columbia that I try and participate in. But it's almost always aimed at how can you simplify this for the public? How can you simplify this without exactly lying about it? And I'm not sure that's what we ought to be doing. I think we should be complicating things. I think it's fun to complicate things. It's more fun to hear a complicated story. So I don't know that there's any real value to this simplification. It's this idea that, you know, there's a very now largely discredited, because it's been proved to be useless, model of science communication called the deficit model. And that's the idea that if we could just improve science literacy, we would improve attitudes towards science. If people understood science better, specific science, if they knew more, they would have a better attitude towards science. This turns out to be absolutely untrue. There's no correlation whatsoever between any measures, and granted there are issues about how we measure it, but any measures of science literacy and attitudes towards science. As you well know, the anti-GMO and anti-nuclear movements and a large part of the anti-vaccination movement are among highly educated people.
Yeah.
You know, they're not wackos out there who didn't make it through high school.
Perhaps this science pseudoscience is too binary, because most scientists are pseudoscientists. I mean, we have to consider all sorts of rubbish all the time, which is clearly pseudoscience. And also the reaction to novelty. And I think that's what Caitlin's getting at, right? I mean, endless histories of good scientific ideas being disparaged and denied access to an audience through journals. I mean, it sort of happens every day in some level. So it would be unfortunate to single out the tobacco industry and the anti-vaxxers. You should focus on us too. I mean, there's a huge amount of pseudoscience in science.
I mean, Boltzmann committed suicide.
Oh, we what? Sorry.
Boltzmann committed suicide because, you know, he just couldn't deal with the fact that, you know, he was being attacked so much on something that was bullshit, because he had an atomistic view of the world and it turned out to be true. Other people attacked him, said, you know, what are these atoms you're talking about? This bullshit.
Yeah, that's true. Okay, I agree. We could do a better job internally as well. Lena.
Hand from the mask, because I can't speak very loud. So I agree with not wanting to simplify when we're first communicating it, but I guess you're aware that when information is communicated between people after that, it's going to simplify. Like, that's making me sound very deterministic and pessimistic, and I'm aware of that, but how do you fact the fact that once the scientific information is out there, it's going to have to simplify just because that's the way content evolves, where they are transmitted between people.
I don't know. I mean, you can't, I agree, you know, sort of. But I think if you, you know, one of the reasons that it simplifies, I guess, or I think, is that this is the way people have been sort of taught to think about it, right? To distill it, to make it simpler.
That I would strongly disagree, because it's just a fact that transmission between humans tend to be lossy. It's never perfect. So whenever you're starting with a very complex thing, it's going to get simplified. Like if you start giving a very complicated sentence to Andres there, and we're trying to transmit it through the room, by the end, it's going to be your dog is cute or something like that. You know? So I'm just not sure what you can do against that part.
Well, I don't know, except that you can, you know, you can correct it every so often, right? I mean, yes, the sentence can go so far, and then somebody, before it goes all the way around the room, somebody says, is this even close to it? And you say, no. And you, you know, you recalibrate somehow or another. So, I don't think we're necessarily stuck with that. I mean, I agree that that's something that goes on. But I don't think that makes it a losing proposition necessarily. I mean, and you know, you do get the information again and again from various sources. So you can recalibrate, or you can be, you know, often that kind of conversation winds up with somebody correcting you as well.
Well, I have to say, I agree with Elena that, you know, often, you know, I work a lot on problems of stochastic processes. And then when we're trying to discuss it among ourselves in a research environment, we're always trying to like simplify to some little toy, you know, scenario that anyone can understand, because, you know, it's otherwise, you know, you just can't communicate it. So you're forced to that simplification level.
Yeah, I'm not sure the simplification is the right demon here.
Yeah, I mean, maybe the simplification isn't the most precise word, but just something where you're trying to compress the information into something that's easily digestible.
Yeah, I mean, but I think we even do that regularly as part of our general practice. I mean,
absolutely.
You know, I work on the brain, but there's no way I could work on the brain. So I picked this little tiny piece of it in the top of your nose because I can maybe get a handle on some of that. So yes, we do that. That's an important strategy in science, I suppose. But we also don't recognize that as the whole story. We recognize that as a piece of the story. And if we can keep that, I mean, maybe that's the problem, is that people then take this simplified version as, well, that's it. That's the story.
Yeah, so maybe it's not like recalibrating the notion of what uncertainty is across human culture, but like doing something more like being transparent about the fact that transmission is always mistaken, right? Like,
yeah.
So that's not uncertainty so much, but yeah.
Yeah, there's uncertainty inherent in transmission, isn't there? Is that what you guys work on here?
Mm-hmm. A good example of an alien thing, which we have to deal with a lot here. So evolution of cooperation. So early on, there were some very simple, non-normative game theoretic frameworks constructed to help us understand cooperation, prisoner's dilemma, etc.
Yeah.
20 years later, that little toy that was meant to help explicate the concept became the basis of the analysis of the real behavior. So people were measuring in the data, are you cooperating, are you defecting? Mm-hmm. A whole industry of totally simple-minded experiments that didn't understand that it was a thought experiment. And I mean, we have to listen to this rubbish all the time. And it's scientists, not pseudoscientists. So that process of excessive simplification, which then infiltrates the way in which data itself is collected, is very deleterious. And it, you know, because I think it's very real.
I like your point about wanting to complicate things, because it seems like in many cases, it seems like society would be better if everyone admitted that things were a bit harder to figure out than they thought they were, except perhaps when we need to act in a crisis. And the other thing I wanted to ask about, which is, you know, maybe just a cri de coeur, but I mean, this for me right now is a profoundly pessimistic time. And, you know, over the past 4 decades, I would say I've gone from very pessimistic to quite optimistic to very pessimistic again. And so for me, there's this sense that, yes, science is a wonderful source of optimism. We could figure out all sorts of wonderful things about the universe, and incidentally also improve things for our fellow human beings if we get the chance. You know, I also think that there's all sorts of wonderful art and music that people will create if they get the chance. And I'm kind of getting increasingly worried about whether that, you know, that will happen. So that makes it a very poignant, contingent optimism. It reminds me a lot of when I grew up on Carl Sagan, and he basically said, either we in the Soviet Union will destroy each other in nuclear fire, or we will travel together to the stars. You know, so that was the dichotomy then. The dichotomies are a little more complicated by now, but it's still this sense that, you know, despite having made radar and the bomb and antibiotics, society isn't yet committed to the notion of progress that we are. And, you know, so, yeah. So it's an optimism about, yes, the day-to-day and the playful aspect of science and the discovery and the mentoring and all those wonderful things. But it's also, it's like, yes, things can be better if we fight like hell for them and get lucky. That's how it feels now to me.
So, but not to put some kind of a cheery spin on this or something like that, but I would say that's actually, being able to say that is something that just a few hundred years ago, nobody would have ever thought to say. Things could get better if we try harder and get lucky. I mean, it just wouldn't have occurred to them, I think, to say something like that. It just wouldn't have even been possible. And so in some ways, I think that's already more optimistic than most of the 200,000 year history of this cockamamie species, you know?
I'll grant you that.
So I agree.
They're troubling times.
I don't want to sugarcoat it. I just, you know, I think we should take account of what is better, in fact, though, and try like hell and hope we get lucky. That's fine. I don't think we've ever had a better shot than that anyway.
How are you going to keep your book from being compared to Steven Pinker's books?
Well, there'll be a lot. I can tell you this, there'll be a lot shorter.
Yes, thank God.
So just in that, there'll be shorter. Yeah, I don't think I've ever finished a Steven Pinker book, actually. Because I pretty much know what the next 100 pages are going to be after the first 100. And actually, I actually don't agree with Pinker about his Enlightenment ideals and all the rest of that. I don't think the Enlightenment, I mean, this requires a bit more scholarship on my part. I'm just sort of playing with it a little bit. I don't think the Enlightenment was a particularly exceptionally great time. I mean, first of all, anything that calls itself the Enlightenment, you have to be a little suspicious of. That's one thing. And, you know, a lot of the really nasty things that happened in science happened during the Enlightenment, like eugenics and physiognomy and criminality issues and things like that, weird racism. All those things started with a lot of it, not started, but developed Enlightenment. So I'm not a big fan of the Enlightenment like Pinker is.
I just think like when your book is being reviewed by reviewers, that's what they'll think of trying to compare it.
Oh, I hope not. Maybe I'll have to put a line in there somewhere. This is, please don't think of Steven Pinker, right? Don't think of Steven Pinker.
Very good. Well, thank you, Stuart. Thank you.